The first group, I kind of struggled teaching stuff at their level. So especially with this being smaller, interrupt me the entire time and be like, this doesn't make any sense. Please, please clarify. I'm going to point you to some good resources so that if there are any gaps in what I'm conveying to you, you can go and learn the stuff again from these people. This Game Sense Motor Lecture with 190, I forget the guy's name, he's like main guy on 190, he's a professor at WPI. Game Sense is out like FRC show, yada yada. They had a pretty good one, I watched it and was like, oh, this is pretty good. It's like slight philosophy differences on how you might size and pick things, but like all the math he presented is correct. If you watched his video, you would get good information out of that. The other resource here is a bunch of data actually provided by Sir Aaron Hill back here when he used to work at VexPro. And this data is super, super valuable for the math we are going to do marching forward. All right, terminology review. Who knows what voltage means? It's okay if you don't. I just want to see where you guys are at. So voltage, current, force, torque. Yeah. Who has been responsible on your team for like sizing the system? And that might just mean bolting it together. Like you picked the motor, you picked the gears, you did it, and it worked without using math. You?
Nope.
Nope. Okay. Have you done it with math?
Simulated one with math.
Okay.
Yeah, I haven't really done actual math, so.
Okay. No, that's fine. I just want to see where you guys are at. So, did that work when you just did it without math?
It just certain things, so yeah.
So, I mean, it's certainly possible. You can pick things that work. Have you done anything that's more arm-ish or elevator? Like deploying an intake or something?
No, our arm was done by our senior.
Okay. Nothing wrong with that. I'm just trying to see where you guys are at, or if you had a cool story we could talk about, that sort of thing. So. It's definitely possible in this day and age to do it all without math, either by copying other things or downloading someone's tool where you are using math, you're not really exposed to it, you're just like typing numbers in like, oh, this tells me it works. And those are good, but I think it's important to understand the background of that, and then you can go and abuse that tool as much as you want. All right, so basic philosophy. Generally, and there's some exceptions like flywheels and that kind of stuff, you're just trying to make the thing go as fast as possible without catching on fire with some margin. And then that's the failure. Most of the time, the motors will break from fire. What causes that fire is high temperature from accumulated current. Like, if it's not a manufacturing defect, if there wasn't, like, some obvious penetration into the robot by someone else's arm breaking the motor, people break motors in FRC because they catch them on fire because...
usually not actually fire.
Well, okay, there's heat.
Motor windings melting.
Yes. There's smoke. Not good smoke. Sometimes there is fire, though.
I really wish you could have been around during the locked rotor stall test.
The what? Oh, the locked
rotor stall test for all the motors. I lost like 10 years of my life.
We really foolishly did the locked rotor stall test on a 60 kilowatt motor last year.
The what?
Yeah. 60 locked rotor. So lock the rotor.
Basically, grab the shaft,
full
and
stall.
Hold it and say, how long did it last?
Yeah. Dim the lights in our building.
Ooh. Mine was a BangBot 705, had like a solid. Like 6-inch flame.
I believe it.
That one had that.
BangBots, not the highest quality motors. They're buying,
yeah.
I suspect, different suppliers' motors. Not necessarily the same supplier every time. Probably shouldn't say that on video, but I said that. The 775s you get from Vex, and actually really all the motors you get from Vex, I believe they're coming from the same supplier, they have data to back them up. Anecdotally, what we've done is matched up with it. There's only been a couple times when we've like done the math for FRC and had the result be way different, and it's been with the BangBots motors every time. That being said, the motors aren't necessarily awful if you just understand that they are not what they are spec to be, that the specs are lower. And actually, if you dig through the Vex data, we'll go over in a bit, they have the true BangBots data, right? You dyno the BangBots?
Yeah.
And you can see that, you know, you look at them, they're not necessarily bad motors, but they are not the published values. So there's really two parts to what we're going to do. The first part is kind of understanding what happens to a motor, what speed and torque it goes at, and that sort of thing, two size things. And the second part is at what point does it catch on fire to feed back into that first part. So, simplified model of a brushed DC motor, which is what everything we're doing in FRC, is if you give it a certain voltage, it will follow a specific line exactly. Now, as it heats up or wears out or that sort of thing, it's going to change. But we're just assuming simple, straight on. And that is called the motor curve. And you'll get motor curves from a good manufacturer. Bad manufacturers will just give you motors. So you might have to generate your own motor curve. And what that is it essentially says that the motor goes from a specific stall torque, and stall means stall, not moving, And it eventually goes to a free speed, free meaning like free and no load. And how that works, and there's math behind this that we're going to gloss over, and you just kind of trust this now, and as you learn more in the future, you can learn the math behind that. The motor, at a spec voltage, 12 volts for this graph, will only ever be on this line. And kind of a little trivia point, it will go this way on the line. And it will go this way in different situations. If you apply reverse voltage and you're still spinning the wrong way, or if someone pushes your robot and you're going faster, not super relevant to here, but people always ask what happens behind those points. This line actually does extend forever. At a certain point, that will cause fire, though, so it doesn't actually hit forever, but it's mathematically valid. Power is this green line. Power is your multiple of force times linear speed or torque times rotary motion. And it would make sense that if torque and your speed are this linear trade-off, that, you know, at 100 and 0, 100% of stall torque, 0% of free speed, you get 0 power, because you multiply by 0. And over at the other side, where you have full free speed but no torque, you get 0 power, because you're going real fast, but you're not pushing anything. And then as you go in the middle, it's a curve, because it's the multiple of those. You know, at the midpoint, you have 50% speed, 50% stall. So that's going to be your maximum. That's the classic, like, calc problem, like, you have 100 feet of fence, what's the biggest trough you can make for sheet? It's a square. So that's why the peak power is in the 50-50. And one thing to take note of this linear representation is, if you were at 10% of your stall torque, you were at 90% of free speed. If you were at 90% of free speed, you're at 10% of your stall torque. That relationship exists the entire time. Does that make sense so far? Am I losing people? Please let me know if that's happening. This last red guy is kind of useful in some cases. That is efficiency. Essentially, it's saying this is always at 12 volts, and the current being drawn is proportional to this torque. Should have told you that. Power electrically is current times the voltage, assuming it's always staying at 12 volts and that sort of thing. Power mechanically is that curve, though. So this is showing that, yeah, you have peak power at 50%, but your efficiency is not great. You're using a lot of electricity. Might or might not be a problem for efficacy. As you start marching towards lower and lower current draw, but also reducing power, you do eventually peak at a peak efficiency over here. Key part of efficiency is, you know, that's mechanical work for heat generated. So if you had magical amounts of weight and motors and that sort of stuff, you could just keep adding more motors and always operate at peak efficiency, but can't do that, unfortunately. So we're going to go over in a minute how you would use this tool to decide what a gear ratio would be, how fast it's going to go through to a certain torque, that sort of thing. But what you're going to need for that tool is decide how comfortable you are loading the motor at different levels. So I did this screenshot, and it's useless, it's small, unfortunately, so we're going to jump to the next site. So this is really new data for FRC. We haven't gotten this ever before. We had this anecdotally. Back in the day, people would tell you, don't stall this motor at more than 30% of stall, it'll catch on fire. That's all you got. You couldn't really verify it, because you didn't want to spend the money on motors. You didn't have a dyno, you could kind of make a robot a dyno a little bit. We did that a couple times, but most of the time we just took that at face value and went, well, it worked last time, maybe we'll gear a little faster this time, that sort of thing. Dex went ahead and did an awesome thing for the community, and that they explored at these different stall levels how long the motor survives. And actually, Aaron in the back, once again, did all that work. So, 775 Pro, the motor we're looking at, because it's like my favorite motor for FRC now. You can see that, you know, if you start at this, where's 2 volts? 2 volts all the way down here. If you start at 2 volts, which, if we go back to this graph, what you do is, when you scale down by voltage, that all scales linearly. So your stall torque will be equivalent to 2/12 of your 12-volt stall torque, because you're at 2 volts and you're carrying 12 volts. And your free speed will be 2/12 of your 12-volt free speed. So you get a yellow line, like, here-ish or whatever. And you go, I'm comfortable with the current or whatever that is analogous to that 2 volts of stall. Even though you might actually be going faster, you're focusing on that percentage of stall. So what this is saying is, if you have that current equivalent to a 2 volt locked rudder stall, the motor essentially survives forever for FRC. So you already know off the bat, if you take nothing else away today, that, like, I can stall a 775 Pro, just by Adam paraphrasing the VexPro site, at 2 volts, and gonna survive forever. Does that make sense? Well, forever for an FRC match. You can see this is 300 seconds down here, and this curve really isn't decaying much, right? I mean, maybe it's like 95% over here from what it was over here. Go up to 4 volts, and it's still pretty good, right? 4 volts is this dashed line. You guys agree with that? Does that make sense?
Do they have any information on the power draw over time if it's stalled?
They do. I'll jump to that in a moment. It's right here. But I wanna finish this trend.
Yeah.
You can see 6 volts. If it's something, you know, that's acting intermittently, my elevator is raising up, not really hanging out there long, coming back down, or you know, my arm has to stay horizontal, but only for like 3 seconds. It's not staying horizontal for 120 seconds. This 6 volt actually doesn't look bad, right? I mean, it does definitely have a performance decay, but the motor's still working here. It has not yet caught on fire or smoked. That's right here, you would assume, when the output goes to zero. But then you start going 8 volts, that's looking pretty scary, right? Like, that's failed in what, 15 seconds? Would seem reasonable? So this is really useful because back in the day, we used to have to guess, this is the limit we can run motors at. We cannot push them harder than this or they will catch on fire. And we're just guessing that number, so you had to be more conservative and you were leaving some performance on the table. Now we have these actual numbers to go on. So that's the extent of the slides. We're going to jump to the whiteboard now and walk through examples of this. And this is where I'm going to struggle to communicate, so I'm not that great at this kind of stuff. So please let me know if what I'm typing or writing doesn't make sense. What we're going to do is we'll march through. You know, we decided based on that Bextro graph, like 2 volts, we're safe forever at 2 volts. And we're going to do like an arm and an elevator and see, you know, how you would do the gear ratio to match that. So this is the stall torque from that graph converted into inch pounds, and this is the free speed from that graph. These are both at 12 volts. If we're going to do this, the whole goal is we're going to have some system, like an arm, and some weight at the end, let's call it 20 pounds. Say this arm is 50 inches long. Arms are easy systems to look at, so you get these nice numbers. You're going to figure out, I have some torque out here required to hold this arm up, like T sub A. And then, what we just said, we decided we're going to stall the motor at 2 volts, that's what we're comfortable at. We're going to figure out what torque that is, a little bit of math. And then we're going to go, how do we make sure that when we're at this pace, the motor does see that torque? So, if we know that stall torque at 12 volts, and we talk about how that graph scales down linearly, and we know we want to operate at 2 volts, how do we calculate the torque on the motor at 2 volts? I'm going to call that T sub M 2 volts. It's going to be the scalar of this 12-volt stall torque times the ratio of the voltages, not equal, sorry. 2 volts over 12 volts. So remember that yellow line marched down linearly. And there's some electrical reasons behind that, but we can spend just as much time on that. I'll lose you guys. So you're going to end up with roughly 1/6 of that 6.3, so we're going to call that 1 inch pound.
What is T again?
T where?
Turn the motor.
T sub motor, 2 volts. That's T sub stall at 12 times 2 volts over 12 volts. This number is in inch pounds. I drop 0.3 and you get 1 inch pound just to make the math easier. So what this thing is, if you take a 775 Pro and put it on a 2 volt power supply and lock the shaft, you will get 1 inch pound out. And the cool thing about motors is, as you start adding voltage and you keep the load the same, you will keep the current and the torque the same. It'll just go faster. Assuming everything is that. So now we got the torque on the motor in the simplified model. Now we need to figure out what the torque on our arm is. So how might we do that with those numbers? How can we calculate this T sub A? Who knows the equation for torque?
Force times distance.
Force times distance. What's our force? There's not a lot of numbers on the board, so feel comfortable guessing. 20 pounds, cool. What's the distance?
50 inches.
50 inches. Does that seem intuitively correct? You got an arm, that's 50, it pretends 50 inches long, you're pushing off with 20 pounds. Would the torque be 20 times 50 here? That seems reasonable. So yeah, you get 1,000 inch pounds. So we have decided that if we can make our system with a gear ratio such that when we see 1,000 inch pounds here, we see 1 inch pound on the motor, it won't catch on fire because we trust their data. But how do we make that match? How do we go 1,000 inch pounds on the arm, 1 inch pound on the motor? What makes that happen?
Gearbox.
I'm going to put pressure on you to guess if you're comfortable.
No.
So gearbox, right?
So you're gonna have, you know, torque on the arm is gonna equal to some gearbox times the torque on the motor. So how do we calculate N then?
Good sir.
I'm not sure.
You're not sure? I know you did isolate this in sixth grade. You're just confused because the numbers are different.
Isolate N?
Isolate N, all right. So the N is gonna be equal to T sub A, which is 1,000 inch pounds. And don't worry, this is where my students struggle teaching this too. It's like, all the math is really simple. All the concepts are really simple. You just, it's like, oh, this isn't what I did in class, this looks different, it's confusing. But it's really not, once you wrap around what it is. All right, so what's that gonna be? What number?
1,000.
1,000, does it have units?
They cancel out, so.
They cancel out. And does it make sense that a gearbox ratio wouldn't have units? Why does that make sense? I'm just gonna come to you.
Well, I mean, there's no units to go by, it's just what are you, it's just number of...
Yeah, well, it's converting from torque to torque, right? So there's not gonna be a unit on there. Whereas like a motor, you know, is gonna be converting current to torque or something. So there's gonna be some units on that number. All right, so, are we done? Can we go to the mechanical team and say, cool, that's our arm, we got a 775 Pro, we're being super conservative, so let's stop at 2 volts. It's never gonna catch on fire, I promise you guys. Just do it 1,000 to 1. Well, what's missing here, maybe? If anything is missing.
Speed.
Speed, exactly. So, I'm gonna give you a little small pseudo model of that graph before. We decided that we want to operate at the equivalent stall torque of 2 volts, but then you want to see what it looks like at 12 volts. So if you were to zoom in and make that 2 volt line, you know, this is your 1 inch pounds or whatever. This is torque here, and this is your speed here. You're then just gonna march that over on your 12 volts. And since you're at 20% of stall torque, you're then gonna be at what percentage of free speed? Remember, at 0% stall torque, you're at 100% free speed. And at 0% free speed, you're at 100% stall torque. And right in the middle, you're at 50% each. And the line's linear.
20,
exactly. There is always going to be the inverse of each other. Is that inverse or converse or, I don't know. Not the right term, probably. So you're going to be at 0.8 times this number on the motor. But so we're going to do one shot coming from this to the arm. We want to know RPM of the arm. It's going to be more than that 0.8, right? What also factors into that?
Efficiency.
Yes, we're skipping that now, but you're absolutely right. I don't know where to sink this in. So omega sub A, the RPM of the arm, is going to be equal to this, you know, omega F12 times 0.8 times what? Or divided by what? What's in the system? The motor's going way fast. What's making it not go fast on the arm? The
gears.
The gears, right? So what are we going to do with that 1,000 number?
Multiply by the gear ratio?
Tell me what that would do. Would that make it faster or slower?
If you reduce it?
If you multiply, I mean, this is a big number, right? 1,000? So we're going to take 18,000, multiply it by 1,000, we're going 180,000. So we're going to divide, right? That's what you're guessing next, I bet. You know, divide that, you're going to get, for people watching this at home, I apologize, this is going to be like totally hard to follow, but that video linked earlier covers all this stuff a lot better. The whiteboard is more for the people here, I guess. So let's do this mental math. You're going to get about 18,500 times 0.8 divided by 1,000. What's a possible number? I'm not going to tell you you're wrong if you guess unreasonable. So. Mental math's really nice to do stuff quick just to trend stuff. You know, if you're doing the real deal...
About 160-ish.
Sounds right. Or actually, that sounds a little fast. I would believe 16-ish.
Okay.
Right? Because 18, this divided by 1,000 gets you 18.6, right? And then 80% of 18.6. So we're going to call that about 16 RPM. Now, I think if you're analyzing an arm, you really aren't too concerned with RPM. You're concerned with some angular range, right? So you probably, you know, I like, once you do this first pass by hand and learn the trends and that sort of thing, I like making an Excel or using someone else's Excel or whatever it is. You might have a box where you type in 75 degrees. You know, that's how far my arm moves. And you go, you do some math on the 75 and the 16 RPM and figure out how long that takes. You can see 16 RPM gets about, is that 1 second per 90 degrees? Does that sound right? 4 seconds per rotation?
Yeah, 4 seconds per rotation.
Yeah. So, That's actually reasonably fast for FOC, I would say. That's about the point where it'd be hard for a driver to control that on their own, but this works. So, Danny can tell the mechanical team, go and buy this from Vexpro somehow, or any of the other great suppliers. It's gonna go this fast, yada, yada, yada. All right, so you guys wanna do that same thing again with elevator, or did that, anything we wanna review here? Did it make sense to you?
It makes sense.
Okay, you feel like you could almost do this with some practice.
That first equation is essentially saying the torque of the motor at 2 volts into the motor is equal to, I thought there was like, isn't there supposed to be a differential equation for that?
Yes, but this linear model works really darn good.
Okay.
And you also, from the motor manufacturer, you get to hand wave a lot of this math, even if the linear model wasn't that good, because they give you all these numbers and they go plus or minus 10%, which is a huge gap. So if the thing's a little nonlinear, the plus or minus 10%, you go, that looks linear.
So the thing is, if the torque of the motor at any one point is equal to the stall torque of the motor at that point.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then you are also right. I guess I don't even know the differential equation. I mean, a couple different things. You are not starting at this point. You are starting it at nothing. But you can reason through, the closer you are to free speed, especially if you're below like 25, 30%, you're going to accelerate pretty quick. And you can do some math to show that, because you're going to start at huge stall. And this is assuming you have like a reasonably sized system, not like some crazy inertia system. Like if you put a flywheel on the second stage of your arm gearbox, your arm's going to take forever to accelerate because you're spinning that up the whole time. And you're going to march down this line, but you're never going to get faster than this number because you have load at that point. You're also never going to hit that number because of what Doug said with friction. You know, you're not actually going to hit that because you're going to eat up some of the friction. However, one useful thing to focus on is if you're going through something and you need to size for that, then the friction hurts you. If you're concerned with the case where the motor's going to catch on fire is when I'm holding this horizontal the whole match, the friction actually helps you. If you have enough friction there, you could even disconnect the motor and you're going to stay there. So, bittersweet there. If you're a team that wants to go really fast and you want to do stuff a lot, you're going to want to go the lower friction route and make sure you're not chilling here to generate high heat, which is true for most FRC games. You know, it seems like with arms, you're not doing this a whole lot. You're generally here or up here, you know, scoring. You're not always sideways. But if you are, you know, there's some there to actually intentionally gearing a little slower and having a little extra friction to make staying here a lot easier. So let's do this in elevator now. I'm going to give it the same force to make things comparable. And the only way to get good at this is do it like 5 or 6 times. You know, this goes the exact same with my kids. Like the first 2 times, they're like, oh my god, this is crazy. And then an hour later, I can give them any arm, elevator, whatever, and march through it once you get used to what the terms mean and all that. Elevator has a slight complication compared to arm, but not too bad. So let's lift the same 20 pounds. You got a string going around some fiber pulley, whatever, and you eventually go to some drum. And that drum has a diameter of 2 inches, diameter. And that's going to go through some gearbox, the ratio N. We should be like facing the camera. That'd be a really bad lecture. Go to some motor, same thing. We feel comfortable at 2 volt stall. You know, maybe you are presenting to the people on your team that don't do math why we should do an elevator or an arm, because they don't believe you. They just do what we did last year and that sort of thing. And you
or
want to
why
teach
them. You should use a 775 Pro and not a motor.
Yeah. So, what do we do? Can you kind of walk me through potentially?
Well, first you figure out how much force is pulling down with the weight, and then figure out how much the pulleys take off.
I think you're saying the right thing. Are you saying you want to figure out what the torque is here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I'll call that T sub D for T sub drop or something. So how do we figure out T sub D? You do only have 2 numbers here. So it does help, but there is a slight trick on this one.
What's the torque?
Oh, since don't you have to say that you find the torque on the upper, and then you have to equate that with the angular?
Well, this is just an idler. So, you know, tension in the string here, same as tension in the string here.
Okay. So
we are hand waving a lot of things, but that's totally valid for what we're doing here. Mm-hmm. So.
Then how do you define the radius for the torque?
Well, the diameter is 2.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I was thinking. So it would just be 20 pounds times, or 1 inch.
Do you get why he's saying 1 inch instead of 2 inches?
Mm-hmm.
Because torque equals force times distance, and that catches kids a lot because D is distance and D is diameter. But torque is worried about the distance from the center point to where it's acting. So that distance is actually the radius, so you get 1 inch. So what would be the torque on the drum?
20 pound inches? Or inch? I forget the units.
I think both are valid.
No, if you do it in the other way, then it's force.
Wait, is it?
Not force.
I'll tell you this. I buy motors all the time from Japanese, American, Singapore, all different manufacturers, and they all do it differently. So you're probably right that there is a right way, but the world doesn't follow the right way.
It is funny how we say foot pounds, inch pounds, but newton meters on the intervention.
Well, it's multiplying, so it doesn't matter.
Or the one that get me is when you get a little farther in stuff, you focus on not these motor curves, you focus on a constant called KT. That's the torque you get per current. And some people go, that is the current RMS for AC stuff, and that's the only way you do it. So I'm not going to specify that it's RMS. You just know that ours is KT RMS. And then other people are in the camp over here that, why would you do RMS? It's always peak, and then they also don't specify. Then there's all the reasonable people in the middle that do either but specify. Really ruins my day. So, you're sizing to 20 inch pounds. You need to go from, what was the number on the motor before? What did we calculate? I erased that.
1, I think.
Yeah, 1 inch pound. So, T sub S at 2 volts, 1 inch pound. So, I mean, are there any key takeaways real quick right off the bat of comparing this number to the number we got on the arm? I mean, the arm number was huge, right? It was like 1,000 inch pounds?
It was 1,000.
1,000. How does 1,000 seem compared to 20? What do you think?
It's a lot bigger.
It's a lot bigger. Also, conceptually, think of 1,000 inch pounds. Let's say you have a 10 inch lever arm. What is your force at the end of 10 inches? So you get 1,000 inch pounds. 100 pounds. That's a lot, right? Like, that's real metal. You're breaking stuff that small. 20 inch pounds doesn't seem that crazy. Like, you're putting more than 20 inch pounds on a bolt all the time, right?
How do you get from 20 inch pounds? Or actually, two questions. So, one, we're assuming that 2 volts as a sort of arbitrary small safe value, yes?
Yes. And there's data to back that up, and I'll close the presentation reviewing that data again. It's kind of a thing you've got to start there.
And then, how do you get from like 20 or 1,000 inch pounds to doing something with a gearbox? Mention that briefly, but
I guess I'm missing the. You're saying before, when we had T sub A on the arm equals 1,000 inch pounds, and then we had, pounds, you know, T sub M equals 1 inch pound. You said, how do you equate those?
Or how do you get the required gearbox constants?
That N? So if you were to draw a model of this, you would say, I guess one intuitive way to think about it is the gearbox is multiplying your torque. You want the motor to only be putting that 1 inch pounds, and you want to end up with 1,000 inch pounds. So frictionless, everything playing nice, you need 1,000 to 1 gearbox, right? Does that make sense?
I don't really do that work for a PT, more or less, at least in mechanics, especially. But is that a lot? Like, is 1,000 pounds something you could do? That seems kind of.
Because of this 1,000 inch pounds, it is big enough that you cannot just slap together whatever off the shelf and have that work. But it's not insurmountable. I feel like our 2008 arm, because I grew up learning from P30 wheels, so it was like you should never gear an arm faster than 4 seconds to race top to bottom because your arm will be so strong it can lift the robot. So I think we had 3 550s and we were still like 4001, so our arm was ridiculously geared.
As a good data point, half inch hex 75 hex shaft is 114 foot pounds to twist it and have it fail in pure shear. So foot pounds to inch pounds, take that times 12, you're in that territory. If you're trying to drive an arm straight through a hex shaft at that.
And remember, you start here. And this is neglecting all dynamic stuff. Dynamic stuff is where you break things in FRC. When you go over that barrier and your arm bounces, technically, if you model everything as infinitely rigid, you get infinite force. You don't, because not everything's infinitely rigid. What's up?
Our arm broke earlier because of that.
Exactly. And you see a lot of teams this year go, I made an arm like this. And we have 5 arms. I'm sorry I'm making it so hard for you to follow me. I'll stay over here. And like, we've made 5 arms like this before, and it's never broken. We crashed it into the rack. We did it all these other years and never broke. Well, those arms before were never so violently being shaken up and down. So, there are things you can do to fix it, like maybe turn down your control loop a little bit while you're doing it, but you might have to march back and change the design. I forgot where I was. So yeah, we calculate the gearbox for the arm, yada yada. Let's do gear ratio for the elevator. N is going to be equal to what divided by what here? We still have T sub M at 1 inch now.
TD divided by TS?
Yep.
Or TM, sorry.
Yep. So TD divided by I'm really bad about going for you. You can get 20 inch pounds over 1 inch pound. You got us?
20.
20. Nailed it. What's your name? You've been great.
Amarin.
Amarin?
Yeah.
Gotcha. Cool. So 20. Once again, any key takeaways? Difference between 20 and 1,000. Because 1,000 made him go, that seems really big. Can you even buy 1,000? Well, how do you guys feel about 20?
That seems more reasonable.
Yeah.
It's easier to make.
Yeah. That's a burst planetary
that's
right there.
That's a two-stage burst
planetary. Yeah, done. 1,000 to 1, there's no off-the-shelf product that'll get you in isolation to get to that much reduction. You can put a couple off-the-shelf products together, but you're not going to be able to nail that right off. So then you can do the same thing here, where you go, we are at some percentage of this RPM, because we are at 20% of stall, therefore 80% free speed, and then you can convert that RPM to linear. Do you guys want to do that, or do you want to maybe march on to more trends and more examples? I guess what time do
we have?
What do you guys think? Do you want to do the velocity calculation, or you want to talk about some more things, maybe answer some questions, do some, do you guys feel like you could, you know, referencing the video, referencing, you know, other video I linked, maybe size the system, or do you want to do some more work?
Austin did a lot, I guess, if you were watching the workshop videos after work, Austin did a lot just modeling the actual velocity response.
Yeah.
If that's going to be work.
Yeah. And that's, to be honest, that's where all of our stuff goes. We do all the same stuff Austin does. I think Austin does everything for differential equations. I do the laser thing, everything's a numerical model, because then you don't have to solve the differential equations. That's what we do for everything, because we already have that solved, so we just put in the next year's parameters and yada yada. That's way past the knee of the curve, though. If you're the team that's like, I want to make my arm go up or down, and I don't want it to catch on fire, how do I do it? You got to at least do this. Because this, if you do it by hand, is like 10 minutes. If you download one of the many tools online, there's the JVM calculator from Momentum 148. You can do this for, I don't know, 15 seconds. You know, as long as it takes you to type the numbers in. But I think it's important before you just use this calculator, you have a grasp of like what is really happening with the motor. So that when you go and do the real thing and something seems different, you can use some intuition to go, oh, okay, I did the gear ratio, he said, and it's going way slower than what I calculated. What might be a problem there?
I think though, if you reduce the radius on that drum, that would decrease the need to gear ratio.
Absolutely. But what might be some practical limits on that? What might be some practical limits on reducing this diameter?
Yeah, probably like maybe half an inch radius.
Yeah, but what would be driving that? Like, why is half inch a problem? Okay, why is it not 1 inch, 2 inch?
The actual shaft could snap.
The shaft could snap. It might be difficult if you're wrapping string up, you might run out of room to wrap. Maybe this isn't actually a string. Maybe we're just modeling the chain as a spring, the string, and you need a sprocket, that sort of thing. So you are right, and that is why, you know, 2 inch isn't that big. You know, I don't think anyone's going to point to your 2 inch drum and go, wow, you're really dumb and inefficient. You should use a smaller drum. You put a 12 inch drum on here, and it's like, okay, come on. Also, recently, 12 inch drum is going to be a reasonable flywheel. You're going to be wasting some energy just to accelerate and decelerate that.
Do you sometimes start like from a design point of view, just saying, okay, we need this. Let's say it's an elevator to go from top to bottom in 2 seconds, 1 second, half a second, and then work from that.
Power absolutely. Yeah.
First,
that's yes.
Then how many motors? I need 2 seconds.
Yeah. So what Doug is saying is, you can look at, and they bring that up. So do you guys feel like, before we jump off, you guys get that, you know, there's difference between elevators and arms? I think the key takeaway is this is very efficient. Also, I'm going to cheat and give you the answer. I think this worked out, as we said in the last workshop, to 130 inches a second. And I know if you compare that 130 inches a second to the arm, the elevator is a little faster. Because the arm is a less efficient way to do this. It's not like 10 times faster, though. Another nice thing is all your controls are linear. So you don't have to deal with the control, you don't have to deal with reaching out, that sort of thing. So, all things equal, elevator is a cleaner solution to arm, but they can be harder to make. Alright, so what Doug is saying is, I kind of jumped ahead and went, someone's already picked the motor. And that's not too crazy. You know, the 775 probes are so powerful now that I bet like first pass 90% of FRC systems, you're going to do this and then go, wow, I'm good. Even at 2 volts, which is very conservative. This is not going to catch on fire, and it goes pretty quick. You know, an arm that goes 90 degrees in a second, that's going to be tough to control if you don't have good code and that sort of thing. But what he's saying is, what if you want to take this box of 10 pounds and go up, I don't know, 8 feet. Oh, this is fun. I'm doing this all in American units, and I'm going to want watts. And you want to do that in 1 second. Should I just do this? Let's make it 5 kilograms and 2 meters, and we want to do that in 1 second. How do we calculate the power? Does anyone know that one? I know Doug knows that one. I'm fine taking it from Doug. No one's taken the right physics class yet. All right, so what is
it? I should remember this. I took the AP test like 5 months
ago. Oh, don't tell us that. Now we know you definitely should
have the expectation.
Start with work done. How do you get work done? It's just like 2 more force distance.
Yes.
Force distance.
All right.
Force distance. Okay. Force distance.
Divide by.
It's d-force distance over dt.
And one thing to reason through, like if you're stuck from the test, you might as well guess. Reason through, what's going to require more power? If the time is fixed and I add more weight, is that going to require more power? More mass, I'm sorry. Yes, and that's just obvious, right? If the time is fixed and the weight is fixed and I add more distance, is that going to require more power?
Yeah.
Yes. If these are fixed and I add more time, do I need more or less power?
Less
power. So, mass, distance, increased power requirements, time decrease. So, oh yeah, I'm missing your gravity. And I will say gravity is exactly 10. Am I really blanking on the units?
Meters.
It's been so long since I've had to do math like in front of people on board, aside from half an hour ago. So what does that get? Just, you can use mental math here. 100 watts. And if we superimpose this power graph back from the 775 Pro, that's kind of not scaled, right? That should cross right there. That peak power is what, like 330 watts or 350 or something?
347.
Yeah. So now, I'm going to pull this back and we're going to talk on the Beck's Pro curves a little bit, kind of close this full circle. Let's remember this 100 watt number. And this is neglecting friction. A reasonable thing to do to all these things is say per stage,
projector.
Yeah, I probably should have been a projector on. Is per stage, if stuff's kind of worse, do like about 0.9 efficiency per stage. If things are better, maybe do like 0.95, maybe as high as like 0.97 per stage for all the stages you have, and just multiply the torque on your motor by that. So you're going to make motor torque disappear. So you're going to fudge it. I can do it on the whiteboard. So that will cause your required gear ratio to go up for something dynamic. For something holding load, it actually helps, and that makes the number go down. So I don't account for that. I think it's better to not account for things that help you to be more conservative.
So you're assuming that the effectual gear ratio is 95% of what?
No, I'm assuming that velocity will carry through 1-to-1. Because that makes sense, but I'm assuming you're going to lose torque. You're going to lose about 10% of your torque per stage.
Okay.
So you're just going to fudge that on the motor side, or you're going to multiply your load by an amount like that. So if we go back to this curve, you can see that at, where's 100 watts? 100 watts, we're at almost free speed. So if you're doing something with 775 Pro, and you're not adding a lot of friction, and you're not doing a crazy long arm that's really going to ruin your mechanical advantage, just off the first pass that Doug said, you can go, yes, this is going to work. I don't know how it's going to work yet. I don't know what gear ratio I'm going to do, but it's at least worth doing the calculation. So what if we had done that calculation and that number was 400 watts? And we're looking at this curve. What does that tell us?
We're closer to the center.
Closer to center? Can we do 400 watts?
It's impossible.
Oh, wait, you can't.
You can't do it. But let's say we were doing exactly like 340. If we did it, we'd be at half stall torque, which if we go back to Aaron's graphs is that 6-fold, and you know, we died after a certain amount of time, that's going to be tough. You can do that for a couple seconds. You know, if you're doing a hang or something, you can design for peak power. I'm still kind of assisting that design back a little bit because of, you know, all the friction and that kind of stuff. But you can get away with it. But you're not going to get away with it for something you're running all match. But let's say we're back at the 400s, so what would you do? Because there's not a higher power motor in FRC. And your strategy guys, the game design, whatever, you gotta lift the box and need 400 watts. What are you gonna do?
Gear down.
Well, but no, they said we have to do it this fast.
You can't get any higher than the peak of that curve, which is 340 watts,
yeah,
and you need 400 to do the job. What do you do?
Because what you're saying is right, but what you're telling them is, hey, go slower.
Increase voltage or more motors?
Increased voltage we can't do legally, unfortunately. Well, I guess it is kind of fortunate.
Are we
but you, yeah, we're already 12. This, oh, yeah, okay. this so is the curve at 12 volts. We can motor. Add more motors, though. So now you're looking in the graph that represents one motor, though. So you're going to take your load, 400 watts, and you're going to assume the motor share, which is a pretty good assumption. So now we're looking at what? What's half of 400?
200.
So we're looking at, like, here, and that's still a pretty good range, right? We're at, like, 80% of free speed, 90% of free speed.
Efficiency
that'll work.
There, yeah.
Efficiency's pretty high. You don't know the gear ratio and stuff, but you know that it's now worth spending the time to do this analysis. And then you start bringing this up, because this is a huge time saver. Because it sucks to do all that analysis in this, you know, like, 10, 15 minutes, and then find that, like, oh, this was never going to work. Or you do the analysis and go, like, oh, with that 2-volt stall, my RPM is, like, 1. And an FSE arm at 1 RPM is not fast enough. I don't care what it's doing. It's probably not fast enough. So then it's like, oh, I need to add more motors, yada, yada. When you do the calculation going forward to modify this curve and, you know, change that stall torque and that sort of thing, you keep the speed the same. Because if you reason through two motors side by side, they're not going to go any faster, like classic sense. They'll go a little faster because, you know, they're overcoming friction better and that sort of thing. But they're not going to go to double free speed. But the torque will do what? What do you think? The total torque available.
Increase.
By?
2 volts?
Not 2 volts.
Just by 2.
By 2. So you got 2 motors. Yeah. So, and when you're doing modeling like this, you know, there are multiple right answers. You can choose to, like, model in the reference frame of one motor and just go, I know I'm doing 2, and you can make the load on the arm be half. You could, you know, make a pseudo motor where, you know, it has all the same parameters, but the stall torque and the stall current are doubled. There's a lot of different right answers. I like anyway, I, you know, for an arm or whatever, I make all my models as a pseudo motor at the shoulder that lumps all the motors together, lumps in any efficiency loss up to that point. It kind of comes up with new parameters for this point just to make, because I feed into the same numerical model for everything I do, and it's easy if everything's the same. Or if it's a linear system, an elevator, I roll forward to the same pseudo motor. But, I'm sorry, pseudo linear motor. But anything that you understand is valid. Because it's all about, can you get an answer that says this is going to work or not, and then kind of convey that to the mechanical team. So
now with some motors available, you technically can have quite a few on your robot.
Yeah, unlimited, right?
And, well, this may be fused panel.
Sure, no, that's, Doug is right, there's an eventual limit.
You know, so much current you can drop on your battery. So let's just say, okay, 2 gets you from 400 to 200, it's a nice place on a curve.
Mm-hmm.
Throw a third one in there, brings you down. I mean, where do you start saying, man, let's try to get it closer to that 2 volts?
Ooh, that's,
you know,
there's so many trade-offs here because, you know, as you start doing the more advanced models, and I'll put my numerical models together, and they'll all draw current on the battery, which draws the battery down, which changes these motor curves because the battery voltage is down. This, you can really creep this analysis and get complicated and complicated. And if you understand the trade-offs of what you're doing and you're willing to be a little conservative, this is all you need to do for FRC. So get to the point of, like, I'm not going to be the guy on the team that everyone points at and, like, ah, our season was horrible because you did this wrong. You're going to at least get to that point. But you can certainly start doing a lot of better stuff. What you do to make the decisions once you've done that analysis is hard. Because it's a trade-off of, you know, a third motor, a third 775 is going to add at least a pound. Because you have the quarter pound, I think, Talon or Victor, it's right about a quarter pound. You have a 3/4 pound motor. If there's no extra power transmission, no extra wires, you still add the pound.
But that's huge from before SensiM Pro, and you're sitting with these SIMs.
Yeah.
That's what we'll say, like, I'm not throwing 3 extra pounds on for a SIM.
So, yeah.
And I wouldn't have made that trade-off. But
yeah.
Now with SensiM Pro, I'm like, okay, we're going to throw more on.
Well, so the other part there is from the arm perspective, if you take a SIM and go back to that left vertical curve, you
it looks a lot different.
Yes. Well, so you can install it at 6 volts,
yeah.
And then you're okay.
Yeah.
So that lets you, yeah.
It's tough to answer that question because, you know, I mean, to really do the trade-off, you have to factor in the wire distance. You have to factor in, you know, a kid has to do the work to hook that up. You're going to spend more money because you have more controllers. The speed controllers cost more than the motor. You know, maybe it's a season for you where 1 pound, you're like, oh, 1 pound, we're 20 pound under, or whatever. You know, there's been years where 1 pound, it's like, I would spend probably way too much money to save a pound on the robot because we're hurting that much. So it's tough to answer that question. I think if you're still doing this type of analysis and you're early on, baseline functionality for everything is already a pretty good goal. If you're then making the decision of, like, high-level trade-offs, you're, I don't know, that's good, you're in a good spot.
That and most things I see in FRC don't require more than, like, 2, maybe 3 300-watt motors getting stuck together.
And, you know, especially the farther you go back in time and watch robots that are doing all the things you're doing, you know, kind of do like some case study examples, and it's more, I'm sorry, less and less power the farther you go back.
Yeah.
There are less legal motors. That's really it. There's less legal motors.
Yeah.
It's also really tempting for the strategy people to go, we need to do it this fast because we're going to score 15 cubes a match, and therefore the speed of the arm is a huge limit. Well, they might be right. I don't know what next year's game is or whatever, but you can kind of come up and look at like case studies of previous years and go, okay, this arm game 2011, you know, arms, elevators, how fast really were the top teams? How fast were the teams that were not as fast as the top teams, but were still scoring a lot, if that makes sense? You know, like 2D4's elevator, super fast 2011. There were probably a fair amount of teams that scored 80 or 90% as much as them with an elevator that was half as fast. I made that number up. There's probably some reasonable number that you don't have to go faster than that. Or like hang this year. Sure, a 1 second hang is great. How much time do you think you spend lining up though for most teams? What do you guys think? 5 seconds? You know? So what's the difference between a 1 second hang and a 3 second hang if you're at the point of like, if I get a 3 second hang, my team's gonna be like stoked. Because last year we didn't have the analogy of a 3 second hang. Cool? Questions? Yes, sir?
It's not exactly actually motor sizing, but.
That's fine.
Do you guys use like any stress analysis?
Very, very minimal.
Okay.
You know, the speed season goes at, we heavily rely on anecdote. I've been, you know, our team, we have a GradCast for our current models, and we have a Google Drive for kind of all our historical stuff. Every time someone that I consider like, you know, worth, you know, looking in and learning a lot of stuff from, and that's a lot of teams, puts a step up, I download that, convert it, put it in there, and, you know, I'll go and look, like, you know, what was one of teams' drive gearbox last year? And it's always pocketed way more than you would think is safe. But it survived, you know, so you kind of have these anecdotal references. I definitely still do stress stuff, though, you know, model it, like, you know, maybe I'm worried about this part of the gearbox bending over, we'll ignore the rest of it and model that just as a simple beam. And there's a lot of simple beam calculators online, so it's super easy and go, if I put a force on that, does it get a buckle? If I put a force this way and go, oh, that seems like too much or not enough, that sort of thing.
Okay.
We'll FEA a little bit, but.
Well, some of the other stuff is from the drive sizing perspective, like an arm with 1,000 inch-pounds on it. From a rigidity perspective, the larger diameter you get, the less stress is seen by the chain or belt or gear or whatever is driving it. But most of those ones, if you go back anecdotally, it's, oh, that's a big number 35 chain. Set up, okay, and then you can look up the chain tensile spec and see where you are with the working load there.
I don't like making absolute statements, but for the generic FRC arm, until you really know better, or until your torque is like you have a 10,000-1 gearbox, you're like, that sounds big, we should really think about this. If you do a 62-35 chain sprocket, so that's the biggest one Beck sells, and then you like a 10 or 12 tooth pinion or whatever, 35, and do whatever reasonable gearbox from there, that's a pretty good starting point. The key part is that 62th guy, though. That's going to get you the biggest diameter to minimize your chain load, like he's saying. And then also, it's tempting and cool to go to gear for the final stage, but there's no big off-the-shelf gear, and you have to water jet to do something expensive, and the gear does not provide nearly as much damping as this product does, or the chain specifically.
Because one of the things is, in that case, the chain is a lot better at spreading that load over multiple teeth. The gear, you're sitting there with one or two teeth.
Yeah.
So if you have a lot of stress, you want to be using the chain as well.
Yeah.
The chain distributes a lot.
And the chain is a fairly good spring as well.
Mm-hmm.
So not only are you distributing
the
load across more
teeth. The whole length of that stretches.
Yeah.
The more links you have, apply that same load, all of those are elastically forming.
Okay.
So, and then like one thing I've seen a lot of teams this year, I had some teams, I got to answer all the pro support emails. Some teams would take a Sunsify Pro through a 300-to-1 versus planetary and direct drive their intake. Like, well, raising and lowering an intake, just directly off the output of the gearbox. Okay. Well, it's a giant reduction gearbox.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, but the load rating chart said I was okay. I'm like, that's great until you're running over defenses, slamming to the ground, or it's partially out and you rammed into the wall. Like, technically, the load per that, well, per everything is fine. But shock loads are one of those.
Because it totally changes when you're looking at dynamic loads. Because now the force generated in power transmission is not necessarily based on the motor torque. It's based on every component in the system has inertia. If you need to spin it, it needs to be accelerated up. And that inertia is multiplied by the gear ratio squared. So quickly what you have essentially is you have the intake with some mass hitting a wall. The wall is winning because it has a lot of mass. And you have a fairly small inertia thing over here, but it appears as a huge inertia because of this gear ratio.
Yeah, that's
the
one gear ratio.
And what you have in between is your gearbox. And you're trying to accelerate this inertia with the wall that wins. You're going to get torque spikes that are, I wouldn't be surprised for the case Aaron's talking about. We have a 3-in-1 versus planetary 775 pro rod intake. Get torque spikes that are like 50 times as big as what the motor would be.
Yeah.
On that stage, and you just
so
pray.
The load rating chart said it's okay, but I'm like, well, the situation you put it in wasn't the same as, like, you can run that without in a safe environment all day.
Yeah. Unless you really, really undersize your system and you just break it the first time you run the arm, install it, the dynamic case is where you're going to break your power tube.
Mm-hmm.
And that's scary because, you know, if you make this first arm and you guys are hesitant, you should, starting with lower voltage, stall it and see what happens. You should stall it at 2 volts. That's fairly low. You know, into a nice hard stop. If your robot doesn't have a nice hard stop, don't just like go through the center of your robot and hit whatever's there. You know, put reason through to a nice safe thing and test it and march up. And if it breaks at 6 volts statically, I guarantee it's going to break at some point. You should be able to. It's kind of scary to go all the way to 12. It's probably valid to not go to 12 in some years, but it's scary because you can't prove it won't break dynamically until you've done a bunch of testing. I'm kind of rambling now. Hopefully that covered the stuff.
Yeah.